order. Urgent question, Mr. Chris Bryant.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. If the Secretary of State for Culture, Media and Sport will make a statement on the government's proposals regarding concessionary television licences.
The Secretary of State for Culture, Media and Sport, Secretary John Whittingdale.
Mr. Speaker, my right honourable friend, the Chancellor of the Exchequer, will be making his budget statement on Wednesday. But following news reports on Sunday, I would like to take the opportunity now to confirm details of the agreement that we have reached with the BBC. Under this agreement, the BBC will take on the cost of providing free television licences for those households over 75, and this will be phased in from 2018-19, with the BBC taking on the full costs from 2020-21. Having inherited a challenging fiscal position, the government is pleased that the BBC has agreed to play its part in contributing to reductions in spending like much of the rest of the public sector, while at the same time further reducing its overall reliance on taxpayers. As part of these new arrangements, the government will ensure that the BBC can adapt to a changing media landscape. The government will therefore bring forward legislation in the next year to modernise the licence fee to cover public service broadcast catch-up TV. In addition, the government will reduce the broadband ring fence to 80 million in 2017-18, 20 million in 2018-19, 10 million in 2019-20, and to zero in 2020-21. The government will consider carefully the case for decriminalisation in the light of the Perry report and the need for the BBC to be funded appropriately. No decision will be taken in advance of charter renewal. The government anticipates that the licence fee will rise in line with the CPI over the next charter review period, subject to the conclusions of the Charter Review in relation to the purposes and scope of the BBC, and the BBC demonstrating that it is undertaking efficiency savings at least equivalent to those in other parts of the public sector. The commitment made in the Conservative Manifesto that all households with an over 75-year-old will be eligible to a free TV licence will be honoured throughout this Parliament. As requested by the BBC, they will take responsibility for this policy from there on. Charter review will provide an opportunity to consider wider issues relating to the purposes and scope of the BBC, and we look forward to using that to engage on the full range of issues with the public, industry and with this House. I will be making an announcement about the process for the review in due course.
Bryant.
What an utter shambles. It's not even the Chancellor who comes to give the budget anymore. Elements are briefed out to the Sunday newspapers, and then the Chancellor goes on the BBC to tell the BBC and the nation what's going to be in his budget 3 days later. There was a time when Chancellors were forced to resign because elements of their budget were leaked. Now we actually get every single element of it briefed deliberately, and he has the chutzpah then to pretend that this is a proper process. But I'm absolutely certain that the Secretary of State agrees with me, because would he not agree that the process for charter renewal and agreeing the financial settlement for the BBC must be open and transparent? Licence fee payers must be consulted, and Parliament should have an opportunity to debate significant changes to funding responsibilities. Would he not agree that no future licence fee negotiations must be conducted in the way of the 2010 settlement? I ask that, Mr. Speaker, not because these are my words, but because they're the words that he himself wrote only a year ago when he was chair of the Select Committee. So I'm sure he's going to agree that this is no way to run a whelk stall, let alone the world's most respected broadcaster. Mr. Speaker, of course, at a time of straitened national finances, every public body must make savings, and that includes the BBC. But the BBC is the cornerstone of the creative industries in this country, and viewers and listeners want a strong BBC making programmes that inform, educate and entertain. And there is a proper way of dealing with the BBC, a green paper, an oral statement to Parliament, an open consultation process, agree what the BBC is for, and then how to fund it before bringing in a new charter. So instead of that, we've got exactly what the Chancellor did in 2010, which the Secretary of State last year was condemning, another backroom deal. Former Chancellor's resigned, as I said before, and yet we still have him coming here with a shabby little deal. Yep. So, let me ask him some specific questions. When will we have the full charter renewal process brought to this House? When will he publish the Perry report that he referred to on decriminalisation of non-payment of the licence fee? Because obviously that's another £250 million that may be missing from the BBC. Will the BBC, under the new agreements that the Secretary of State is announcing, have the power to end concessionary licences for those who are over 74? And how much is the government intending to cut the BBC's overall income? By £650 million, £850 million or £1 billion? How many jobs does he expect to go in an industry which is one of the few in the world where we excel more than any other? Is the licence fee going to remain for the full 10 years? Will the BBC be allowed to charge for the use of the iPlayer? And will those who already have a licence be required to pay extra for use of the iPlayer? And when was the Secretary of State, incidentally, told of this new policy? Was it late last night? Was it half an hour ago, just before he came to the chamber? Or has he been involved all the way? If there is a means of protecting the public finances and at the same time securing the BBC's future, we will wholeheartedly support it. But if this is just a smash and grab raid on the BBC, if it ends up undermining the BBC, then we will oppose him every step of the way.
Secretary of State, Secretary Whittingdale.
I have to say I'm slightly surprised, Mr. Speaker, that the right honourable gentleman seems to be so upset that I've taken the trouble to come and answer his question today in detail. The government has, in response to his questions, spelt out in some considerable detail precisely the terms of the agreement that we have reached with the BBC. And I can tell the right honourable gentleman that I and the Chancellor have been involved in the discussions throughout, and that the BBC have reached this agreement, and we are all content that it both delivers our objective of helping to reduce the deficit, while at the same time giving the BBC some of the guarantees they need about their future financing and the system by which the licence fee is raised. However, it does not preempt charter renewal. And I can tell the right honourable gentleman that the charter renewal process will be open, it will be transparent, and it will involve as many of those who wish to participate as possible. And I shall be coming before the summer recess to give further details and to publish the green paper on which the charter renewal process will be based. And at the same time, I hope to be in a position to publish the Perry report. The right honourable gentleman appeared to ask a number of questions which were already answered in the course of the statement. I can tell him once again that the case for decriminalisation, which is considered within the Perry report, will be considered as part of the charter renewal process, as will indeed the future scale and scope of the BBC and the licence fee from the period after the charter process takes place, will, we anticipate, rise in line with the CPI as long as the charter renewal process does not result in any changes to these purposes and scope of the BBC. All of those are spelt out in the statement that I've given today, but with regard to the charter renewal process, it is right that this should be an open process in which no decisions have yet been taken, and we will be publishing the details of that very soon.
Mr. Norman.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and it's an honour to follow the right honourable gentleman as chair of the committee, thanks to the support of this House. May I ask him whether he shares my view that scope and funding for the BBC must be considered together, as they have not always been in the past, and if that is the case, whether he can assure the House that that will be part of his plans over the next year?
I agree with my honourable friend, and perhaps I can take this opportunity to congratulate him on his taking on the position, the very important position, of chairman of the DCMS Select Committee. I can absolutely confirm to him that the scale and scope of the BBC will lie at the heart of the charter renewal process, and the level of the licence fee will be considered as part of that, because obviously he is right that once we have decided the scale and scope of the BBC, that will then determine how much money is needed. And if it is the conclusion that more money is needed, then we will consider any bid from the BBC at that time. The guarantee we have given is that the licence fee will rise in line with CPI over the next charter period, subject to the conclusion of the charter review. I have to say to my friend, that is exactly what I just said in the statement.
Mr. John Nicholson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, sir. We've, of course, been down this route before. In 2010, the Coalition announced plans to require the BBC to fund licences for the over-75s, and now apparently the government is chancing its arm again. Now, the Right Honourable Gentleman, of course, is on record as saying it's very difficult to justify why my mother, his mother, not my mother, doesn't have to pay a licence fee. Well, I can tell him how he can justify it, Mr. Speaker, sir, because if it's not means-tested for his mum, it would be means-tested for my mum. And my mum, like thousands of pensioners across the country, would simply be far too embarrassed to fill in a form to get a free television licence. So I'll introduce you to her sometime, sir. So can I get clarity? Can I get clarity from the Right Honourable Gentleman? Will he require, or indeed will he allow, the BBC to means test television licences for the over 75s?
Yes. Can I repeat to the Honourable Gentleman what I've just said in the statement, which is that there is a very clear commitment in the Conservative manifesto that all households with an over 75-year-old will be eligible for a free television licence, and that will be honoured throughout this Parliament. Following that, the BBC have requested to take on responsibility for that policy, but that will be in the course of the next Parliament.
Mr. John Redwood.
I welcome the announcement. Will he confirm that in the bigger review he will pay special attention to where the BBC is currently competing using tax-based subsidy to undercut and drive out of the market other media providers?
Well, my right honourable friend raises an important point, and it is one that will certainly be a matter that will be considered during the course of charter renewal, but I think that is the kind of issue that is best considered over a period when we have the opportunity to hear from all those who are affected by the activities of the BBC.
Mr. Ben Bradshaw.
This government, Mr. Speaker, has already forced the licence fee payer to fund broadband rollout, the failed vanity project of local TV, and now it's making the BBC a branch office of the Department for Work and Pensions. Does the Right Honourable Gentleman not accept that this is a significant assault on the BBC's independence, and that it is the part to Parliament that the BBC is answerable, not to government? He published a report just before the election on the future of the BBC in which he said it was absolutely paramount that this House and the other place were consulted fully on anything to do with charter renewal. He has broken that promise today, and I'm extremely disappointed that he has.
Well, with regard to the first point from Right Honourable Gentleman, as I announced, we will actually be phasing out the broadband ring fence over a period. And I seem to recall it was his government who financed the digital switchover from the licence fee. However, as I've said, the licence fee settlement is a matter which will be considered as part of the charter renewal process, since it will obviously be affected by any decision that is taken as a result of charter review about the purposes and scope of the BBC. So we have sought to give the BBC the assurances that they have requested, but it has not in any way preempted the decisions which may be reached as part of charter review.
Julian Knight.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My right honourable friend will no doubt be hearing many protestations of poverty on behalf of the BBC in this place today. But is my right honourable friend aware of the vast sums spent by the same BBC on delivering the Salford Media City and New Broadcasting House in London, and how this bipolar approach has effectively drained the rest of the country of investment, and the Midlands in particular.
Well, I believe that the investment by the BBC in Salford was a beneficial one, and it is very important that the BBC demonstrate that they are serving all the regions and nations of the UK. But nevertheless, the questions that he raises are certainly ones which we will be looking at as a part of the Charter Review.
Mrs. Helen Goodman.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm very sympathetic to what the Secretary of State has said about removing the broadband ring fence and raising the licence fee by CPI. But wouldn't it have been more sensible to have ended this foolish subsidy rather than sticking with the commitment in the Tory manifesto? Instead of messing up the BBC's finances, could he say exactly what the financial burden on the BBC will be from this decision?
Well, I'm interested to hear that the Honourable Lady is calling for the removal of free television licences from the over 75s. However, it was very clearly spelt out in the Conservative manifesto that they would be preserved for the entirety of this Parliament, and I can tell the Honourable Lady that this party does not break its manifesto pledges.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm delighted that my right honourable friend has been able to give the full details of the financing package rather than the partial details we learnt on Sunday. Does he agree with me that the BBC, with its many excellent world-class services, is one of the British institutions most admired around the world? And is he confident that that can remain the case under the financial settlement that he set out today?
I'm grateful to my honourable friend, and I agree with him entirely on both points.
Jonathan Edwards.
Okay, Mr. Speaker, when fully implemented, this will effectively be a cut of around 18% in the disposable budget of the BBC based on the value of today's licence fee, with liabilities increasing as a result of an ageing population. What guarantees can you give to S4C that their budget will not face a similar cut in future?
S4C is very well.
Well, I am confident that the BBC, which has a good record of achieving efficiency savings, can continue to do so over the coming years. And it is the case, of course, that the taking on of the cost of providing the free TV licence is being phased in and will not start till 2018. With respect to S4C, I think it is reasonable to expect that S4C should make the same kind of efficiency savings that the government is looking for the BBC to make.
Sir Peter Bottomley.
I think my right honourable friend has calmed down the atmosphere over this, and that we look forward to a deal which the BBC can live with as well as this House. It's important the BBC should be able to go on exploiting and introducing new technology as well as keeping old services going. Can you say whether the age of 75 is fixed forever, and if it can be changed, would it be changed by proposal from the BBC or by this House?
Well, the age of 75 is fixed for the duration of this Parliament, because that is a pledge in the Conservative manifesto. As I indicated, after that, it will be for the BBC to take on responsibility for this policy, and therefore they may examine a number of options.
Councillor Stewart.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Of the £942 million raised in the West Midlands on the back of the BBC licence fee, only about 8.5% actually spent in the region. When the Secretary of State modernises the licence fee arrangements, will that include an obligation to have regional commissioners so that spending in the regions is more in keeping with the amount of money raised in the regions?
Well, I am aware that this matter was recently debated, and my honourable friend the Minister responded to government at that time, but the point the honourable lady raises is one that will certainly form a part of the Charter Review, and we will consider those options and any others at that time.
Mr. David Nuttall.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Whilst a licence fee might have been an appropriate way of funding the BBC back in the 1920s, a compulsory licence fee is no longer justified in the 21st century. Does the Secretary of State agree with me that if the BBC's output is as popular as everyone claims, then if it changed to a subscription model, people would be queuing up to go and buy the TV licence.
I'm grateful to my honourable friend, who makes an argument which I'm sure will be one of those which we can consider at the time of charter review, and I would encourage him and indeed anybody else to make such submissions at that time.
Paul Farrelly.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I want to congratulate the Secretary of State on his appointment publicly, and we served together for 10 years on the Select Committee, during which we looked at the BBC many times. In our last report, in a conclusion proposed by him as chair, we said the following. It was wholly wrong that 2010 licence fee settlement, which permitted the licence fee revenue to be used for new purposes, was not subject to any public or parliamentary consultation. We recommend that income from the licence fee be used only for the purpose of broadcasting or the production of public service content on television, radio and online. So could the Secretary of State explain why, just 5 months on, he now doesn't still agree with himself, and why so early in his appointment he's not stuck to his guns but has rather allowed the Chancellor to call all the shots?
Well, I'm grateful to the honourable gentleman. He and I have agreed many times when we served together in the committee, but I don't agree with him on this particular occasion. I would disagree that what I have announced today conflicts with what is in the Select Committee report. The licence fee settlement will be subject to the debate and a widespread consultation. This is not a licence fee settlement. What we have sought to do is to give the BBC some confidence in when they come to plan for the future that if the Charter Review does not conclude that there should be changes in the purposes and scope, then they can look forward to a rise in line with inflation after that time. But it does not rule out any option which we will consider during the process of Charter Review.
Mr. Philip Davis.
Given that the BBC gets more income in every time a new home is built, would the Secretary of State agree with me that the BBC has actually been pretty well protected during the period of austerity that other parts of the public sector have faced? And would he agree with me that if the BBC ever feels short-changed from sucking on the teat of the licence fee payer, it can always try its luck in the commercial sector and move to a subscription model?
Well, my honourable friend is absolutely right that while it is the case that the BBC licence fee has been frozen since 2010. Nevertheless, the BBC's income has been rising year on year due to the growth in the number of households. And that is something which is not widely recognised but should certainly be taken into account in these decisions.
Kate Hoey.
Speaker, can I welcome the continued commitment to the concessionary licence fee for over 75s, which is a lifeline to many, many elderly. Can I also say to him that millions of people love the BBC, but millions of people also in this country believe that sometimes the BBC has got involved in too much frippery and has gone wide of what its basic remit should be? And could he actually look at this and make sure that these kinds of things are looked at during the discussions over the licence fee renewal?
I am grateful to the Honourable Lady. That is exactly the kind of matter which I think it is appropriate to consider during the course of the Charter Review, and I hope that she and others will make submissions if they feel strongly on these points.
Mr. Michael Ellis.
I welcome the announcement, and I'd like to work with the BBC. I'd like my right honourable friend to work with them to improve the position. The Northampton Chronicle and Echo and the Northampton Herald and Post are very good local newspapers. Does he agree with me that they and many other local newspapers around the country should not be put in jeopardy by an overweening website, BBC website, and other BBC branches and units, which have had a tendency, using taxpayer-subsidised licence fees and other sources, to have an effect on those local press organisations?
Well, I am aware of the concerns of the local newspaper industry and indeed others about the impact of the BBC's licence fee-funded activities on commercial providers, and that certainly will be one element which we will consider during the course of Charter Review.
Mr. Barry Gardner.
Thank you, sir. The Secretary of State has insisted that the Conservative Party does not break its manifesto commitments, but it would appear that it's quite happy to get somebody else to pay for them. Exactly. Given that the BBC is going to have a reduced income as a result of his announcement today, could he say how much that reduction in its income will be, and what discussions he's had with the Foreign Secretary about whether it will affect the World Service, which many of us care deeply about?
Well, I have already given the House the figures for the reduction and the phasing in of the cost of maintaining the over 75's free licence fee. How that affects precisely on the BBC's income will also be affected by other factors, such as indeed the one my honourable friend just mentioned, which is the rising number of households who will be paying the licence fee. In terms of the impact on the World Service, as I say, this does not come into effect until 2018. The World Service, again, will be one of the activities of the BBC that we will be considering during the course of charter review.
Andrew Bridgen.
Speaker, it's clear, Mr. Speaker, that the BBC and their, I believe, their former employee, the Shadow Secretary of State, believe that the continued criminalisation of 150,000 of our citizens each year, 70% of whom are women, is a price worth paying to protect the BBC's income stream. What does the Secretary of State think?
Well, I am, of course, aware of my honourable friend's views on this issue, and it was partially as a result of his pressing that case that we commissioned the report by David Perry examining the consequences of decriminalisation. We will be publishing that report at the time that we issue the Green Paper, and it will form part of the Charter Review process, and it will inform that process, and we will take decisions in the light of it.
Seema Malhotra.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. We should be proud of the BBC, which is respected and valued not just in Britain but across the world for the quality of its output. What impact does the Secretary of State expect a £650 million bill, a fifth of the budget of the BBC's, to have on its ability to invest and remain a world leader and a great advertisement for Britain across the world?
Secretary of State.
Well, as the Honourable Lady knows, this announcement which I've made today is the result of an agreement with the BBC, and I am confident that the BBC will be able to continue to provide exactly the world-class kind of programming which she has just described within this new financial settlement.
John Persglove.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. What discussions are being had around the importance of the BBC identifying new streams of revenue generation?
Well, I mean, the potential for changing the licence fee in the long term as the mechanism of funding the BBC is a matter which we will be examining during the course of Charter Review. I think there are some options which I personally am not particularly attracted to, such as advertising, but nevertheless there will be others which will certainly be worth considering as a longer term option for the future.
Griffith.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, companies like Tinopolis in my constituency are part of a very important Welsh language broadcasting industry. Now, the Secretary of State has worryingly just told us he would anticipate the BBC cutting their contribution to S4C funding. What guarantee can he give us about direct government funding to S4C and whether he anticipates cuts there to an industry which has already suffered enormous cuts and has a long lead-in time for good quality programmes?
Well, the government, as the Honourable Lady knows, already does fund S4C £6.7 million direct funding, and we have set out already our intention for the next two or three years. Beyond that, that will be something that we will consider at that time.
Mr. Nigel Evans.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Secretary of State may remember when I sat on his select committee that I had a go at the BBC Trust Chief, Michael Lyons, about some of the eye-watering salaries they pay to top executives and so-called top talent, and I had a go at the £6 million they were paying Jonathan Ross. Well, it seems, I read recently, that they'll be paying Chris Evans millions just so that he can present Top Gear.
Yes.
Isn't it absolutely right that the BBC should get a grip on some of these salaries, and it is right that they should play their role in showing some restraint in the coming years?
Yeah. Stay.
Well, as I'm sure my honourable friend would agree, it is not for the government to set individual salaries for employees of the BBC. However, nevertheless, I have sympathy with the views expressed. I think the BBC has already made quite a lot of progress in this area. Certainly, some of the salaries which he describes as eye-watering are no longer being paid. But obviously, the BBC will need to cut its cloth to live within its financial means.
Jason McCartney.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. With BBC productions such as Happy Valley, Remember Me and Peaky Blinders having been filmed in my beautiful part of West Yorkshire, will the Secretary of State continue to encourage the BBC to invest in regional production?
Perhaps I might congratulate my honourable friend on his election to the Select Committee, and I'm sure that he will be he will take advantage of his position there to make these points. But I absolutely agree that the BBC does have a duty to serve all the nations and regions of this country, both in terms of the content it broadcasts and where it is made.
Mr. Peter Bone.
Mr. Speaker, I don't know when the Minister made his asked the urgent question why the amplification was wrong, because he did seem extremely loud and almost like a rant, which is not like the Shadow Minister at all. But he did make, Mr. Speaker, a very important part. He made a very important point about this information appearing in the media before the budget. And the Chancellor, I'm sure, would be as concerned as the Minister that this information occurred in the media before it came to this House. And I wonder if the Minister has initiated a leak inquiry.
Well, I can say to my honourable friend that I cannot help him or enlighten him as to how this information did come before the newspaper. However, I can say to him that it was as a result of that that we decided it was only right that we should come to the House at the earliest opportunity to respond to the urgent question tabled by the Right Honourable Gentleman opposite in detail.
Mr. David Ratley.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Like many people in this House, I fully respect the BBC's broadcasting values. But does my right honourable friend agree that it's time to have a full review of the BBC's online ambitions to ensure that national media, particularly national newspapers and other media outlets, are not disadvantaged in carrying out that review?
I do agree with my honourable friend. I think it is time that we had a thorough review of every aspect of the BBC's activities, and that is precisely the purpose of the Charter Review, which we are shortly to embark upon.
Peter Heaton-Jones.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Speaking as a former long-term inmate of the BBC, would the Minister agree with me that the most important thing is to make sure that the licence fee is now fit for purpose in the 21st century, in particular to close down this so-called iPlayer loophole, and also to encourage the BBC to continue to make efficiency savings, because as I saw for myself, you could frankly cut great swathes of middle management tomorrow and EastEnders would still start at 7:30.
Well, I'm grateful to my honourable friend. I agree with him on both points. Specifically on the iPlayer loophole, the original conception of the licence fee was that those who enjoyed watching television should pay a licence fee from which the BBC would be funded. Of course, at that time, the opportunity to view catch-up television did not exist, but certainly it would have been the case that I think those who created the licence fee would think that the licence fee should apply equally to those watching catch-up as it does to live TV. And so it is merely to reassert that principle that the government has agreed that we should change the law so that in future catch-up TV is treated in exactly the same way as live TV in terms of the requirement to pay a licence fee.
Mr. Bob Blackman.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Can my right honourable friend update the House on what changes there will be to the processes of identifying those eligible and also granting exemptions to the households that qualify?
Well, in terms of the future of the licence fee, that is a matter, specifically the aspects about decriminalisation, which is the enforcement point, which has been examined in some detail by David Perry. And I don't want to anticipate the publication of his report, but that will feed into Charter Review, as will indeed the other aspects that he has raised.
Mr. Philip Hollobone.
Given that most people get most of their broadcast news from the BBC,
In the next 2 years, BBC News will face one of its greatest ever challenges in having to remain impartial over whether this country decides to leave the European Union or not. How will the Secretary of State satisfy himself that the BBC will adhere to its trust principles to inform and educate without appearing to be on one side of the argument or the other?
Well, of course, the BBC is subject to a requirement to maintain impartiality and objectivity, as indeed are all broadcasters. But I would agree with my honourable friend that the importance of maintaining that principle is, if anything, even greater for the BBC. At the moment, complaints on impartiality and fairness, you will be aware, are considered by the BBC Trust, but the governance arrangements for the BBC will be one of those issues which we will be looking at during the course of charter review.